to say it's an absolute pleasure to be invited to participate in this conference, and particularly being able to undertake the exercise of exploring, you know, the cultural references that are within language about Aboriginal fire use of my people from my country. And certainly as I get into the discussion, you'll find that there's certainly some very interesting questions that need to be, discussed in terms of the current discourse and debate around Aboriginal fire stick farming. But, before I start the presentation proper, I'd just like to say Nyatu Mayapawangan Nyutgong Warandri Alamin Marapan and Miringyung. What I've just said is I acknowledge that this is the country of the Wurundjeri, and pay my respects to the ancestors, elders and people, past and present. As you're probably aware, I'm a Gunditjamara man from southwest Victoria, and I'm employed by the Victorian Aboriginal Corporation for Languages, who's peak body for Aboriginal language research and reclamation in Victoria. I've been employed as the coordinator of the Southwest Aboriginal Language Program since 2009, and I've been working in and around Aboriginal language reclamation and revival for around 20 years. Obviously, it may be some in the audience asked, you know, what has language got to do with burn and bush? And you know, clearly, we all understand that language is pretty well much the vehicle for cultural expression, oral expression of culture, and it is the body in which Aboriginal cultural knowledge lives and the vehicle through which it is shared. So in the context of this conference, I've looked at how, what evidence, you know, language provides in terms of Aboriginal fire practices, and compared this to the contemporary constructions by non-Aboriginal people of Aboriginal fire use. Before we start, I'll provide a bit of a cultural context to Aboriginal people and our relationship with fire from southwest Victoria. This is a traditional story from country of how the Gunditjamara people got fire. A long time ago, fire belonged to the Crows, who lived at Garryward, the Grampian Mountains. They were greedy Crows, and they knew fire was of great value. A little bird, Yuloinkia, the fire-tailed finch, was watching the Crows making fun and games with the fire sticks, and one fire stick fell to the ground. And little Yuloinkia picked it up and flew away. The Crows chased him, and Yuloinkia soon grew tired. So he passed the fire stick to Tarakuk, the kestrel hawk. Tarakuk took the fire stick from Yuloinkia and flew as high as he could. And the sparks and the embers falling from the fire stick lit all the country behind him. From that day on, Gunditjamara has had fire to this day. Now this story is symbolic of fire falling from the sky and demonstrates Gunditjamara witnessed the many volcanic eruptions that have occurred for millennia in southwest Victoria. Approximately 2,000 volcanic craters exist across Gunditjamara country, which is almost wholly situated within this southwestern Victorian volcanic plain. In looking at the 10 Aboriginal language groups across the region in southwest Victoria, and you can see a map there which has got the red boundary for the area of language groups that I research and support. I've established multimedia digital databases of all the language references that are available for all of these languages. and I'm able to conduct pretty sophisticated searches for information. And in looking at all of the databases I have, we find a very different picture to what the contemporary bush burning theories. For a start, nowhere are there any words for intentionally lighting forests or burning off forests to the degree that's been promoted in terms of publications as put out by Gamage and various others. The only references that I can find within language that refer to Aboriginal people burning bush are one, which is Bawa Barakich, and this means burn swamp grass. And this is described by James Dawson from his publication in 1881 as follows. In summer, when the long grass in the marshes is dry enough to burn, small areas are set on fire in order to attract birds in search of food, which is exposed by the destruction of the ground cover. And then, you know, a day later, mob would go back to that spot and wait in ambush to maybe catch an unlucky bird who happened to be attracted to the trap. The other reference to fire burning was Mayapa Borberta, and it means make smoke signal. Again described by Dawson as follows. Great meetings are held periodically in summer by agreement among the friendly tribes. But any two chiefs have the power of sending messages and commanding the attendance of the tribes. Sometimes, instead of dispatching men to give notice of a meeting, a signal smoke is raised, setting fire to a wide circle of long grass in a dry swamp. This causes the smoke to ascend in a remarkable spiral form, which is seen from a great distance. Thus, the summons given is strictly attended to. Or if there's not a suitable swamp, a hollow tree is stuffed with dry bark and leaves and set on fire. Or a fire is made on a hilltop. These assertions made by the researchers like Gamage and that people had changed the Australian landscape through centuries of burning large tracts of forest bushlands seems pretty implausible for a whole range of other reasons. If we look at the Aboriginal population density, particularly in southwest Victoria at the time first European contact, it's been pretty contentious in terms of what the actual numbers are for many, many years. But figures given by Dawson back in 1881, this is nearly 70-odd years, 80 years after first contact with Europeans, was that there were around 22,000 people living in the region. And this figure, whilst it's been vigorously contested, there's no dispute that there was clearly 190 to 200 clans living across the region. These clans resided in stone hut villages, permanent residences, within specific areas of country and in close proximity to each other with clearly defined boundaries. Additionally, the country of southwestern Victoria is renowned for its constant high winds. So making controlled burns of large areas, which are predominantly hardwood forests, totally impossible. Creating a bushfire with such high potential to travel across these boundaries, putting people's lives at risk, would have been dealt with severely by the neighbouring tribes. It would have been the last bushfire you would have lit. The mob would have come back and just taken you right out, and that would have been the end of you and your mob. So there's a whole range of cultural factors that were, which clearly would have been enshrined in law, cultural law, that speak to not lighting bushfires that would would travel into other people's country and affect their livelihoods. Furthermore, such fires such as these would not have been necessary due to the abundance of food resources in the region. And they certainly would have had the opposite effect to what researchers assert is one motive for bush burning, being Aboriginal bush burning, being food production. We're all pretty aware, you know, bushfires destroy animal and human plant resources. They drive off the wildlife and kill the remainder. So looking at the lack of words within language to describe burning bush clearly casts a large question mark over the current theories around Aboriginal fire stick farming nationally. Whilst there is a word for bushfire, which is mud bitch, it refers to fires on the rare occasions made by lightning strikes, or fires made from volcanic activity. And that's the definition of the word within the language reference. Anything associated with bushfire made by lightning was pretty well much seen as evil by us mob. And no fire would be taken from that fire to light campfires, or no animals killed by a fire caused by lightning were eaten. Fire made by volcanic eruption was a different story. It was seen as a gift from Bernmiel, who is our great creator spirit. Another motive for Aboriginal fire stick use is fuel, given as fuel reduction. Once again, there's no real references in cultural practice or language to talk about issues associated with fuel reduction, and we'll explore that in a pre-colonial context. We'd certainly appreciate that, you know, large groups of animals grazing on grasses and plants, together with the diverse microecologies in forests and grasslands, quickly broke down the debris and served to reduce the risk of wild bushfires. It was the European farming practices which pretty well much wiped out the large numbers of every species that would have contributed to this fuel reduction in forests and grasslands. Additionally, native grasses are not very flammable. The introduction of the foreign grasses has considerably increased the potential and ferocity of bushfires, and it's for this reason we see the burning off practices continue today. Interestingly, down in southwest Victoria now, a lot of efforts are about replanting the region with native species of grass in recognition of their non-flammability across an area which has significantly been converted into high-density pastoral lands. So where do we find evidence in historical records of Aboriginal people intentionally lighting fires? In researching this paper, it's clear that the practice emerged after Europeans arrived, Aboriginal people burning forests and bush, after the Europeans arrived, and as a means of fighting fire, arms with fire. From the time of the arrival of the first Europeans in the Western Districts in the 1800s, the Gunditjamara tribes were fighting a sustained guerrilla war against the squatters. And you know, there's heaps of evidence in historical reference about how that fight was conducted. And predominantly it was the use of Aboriginal use of fire to try and burn them out. And here's a few references. Paul N. Bridie in 1883 wrote, "Aboriginal attempts at stealing squatters' property naturally led to reprisals in which superior arms of the settlers and their servants told with fatal effect upon the Aborigines. The permanent arrival of the Hendis at Portland and surrounding districts in 1838 heralded a different land use, and their intentions to graze flocks of sheep over extensive areas conflicted with Aboriginal land tenure. From this time on, local Aboriginal clans began burning bush as a means of driving the Hentis away. Again, in November 1839, Charles Tyres reported that Wedge's station had suffered great losses in sheep and cattle, with up to 40 sheep at a time being taken, and the country where the station was situated had been burned by Aborigines. C.B. Lawler Hall at Lexington in 1841 recognised this much when he wrote, "The diplomatists of their tribes pleaded justification that their kangaroos and emus were driven away by the flocks and herds of the settlers for reprisals upon an invading enemy, stimulating a sort of guerrilla warfare." On the 19th of February 1841 at Wedge's station, where a swivel gun had been deployed, Aborigines had been very troublesome in attempting to burn them out and steal sheep. They succeeded in burning the country for some miles behind the station and one of the outstation huts. And, you know, Robinson, who was the Aboriginal protector in the 1800s, in a report that he'd written back to Governor Latrobe in 1842, "The natives ignite the bush, which would scatter the flocks and the settlers in all directions." And it goes on there are literally thousands of examples of evidence in historical records of Aboriginal people who burn the settlers out and their stock, but very little evidence of Aboriginal people using this fire stick method for fire control, fuel reduction, or bush management techniques. So, some of the impacts, pretty disturbing outcome is of historical and contemporary bush burning practices is its impact on Aboriginal cultural heritage, which isn't just physical in the context of, okay, scar trees and various other culturally significant sites, but it's also, you know, intangible relationships through totems and dreaming stories of our Aboriginal people that always involve animals from the region as part of those stories, as demonstrated with the how the Gunditjamara got fire story. So Aboriginal cultural heritage and particularly creation stories are embodied within the spirit of all those living animals within our traditional country and within the bush, and certainly these have always been adopted at an individual level and at a clan and tribal level as totems that are afforded the protection of the person whose totem that animal is. So the destruction of forests which contain the scar trees used to manufacture canoes, weapons and tools, which are evidence of Aboriginal cultural occupation in specific areas of country. They are extremely critical to retain and maintain as a demonstration of the richness and diversity of Aboriginal cultural heritage for all Australians to enjoy. But they also are evidence under current legislation such as native title, where they can you can demonstrate a physical evidence of Aboriginal continuation of occupation of a particular country, area of country, and therefore substantiating to a certain degree native title claims. Bush foods such as murnong and medicinal plants are increasingly rare, and you know the burning off practices impact on their potential for their reintroduction. They're increasingly rare, as are biological resources that were used by Aboriginal people, such as resins and gums in tool manufacture and for paints for art and ceremonial events. So in a sense, there's a whole raft of connections through culture that are significantly impacted on by our current burning off practices, and certainly stifle to a large degree the potential for local Aboriginal cultural heritage revival. Some of the artefacts that you'll find are quite significant. You might think fire doesn't really have an impact on stone artefacts, but it does if you're trying to look at an archaeological perspective. You see a rock like this, it's obviously a grindstone. If fire's been over this, you've got less likelihood of being able to find specific fragments, microscopic fragments of plant that may be still embedded within the grindstone to demonstrate what sort of species of grass was used used by this stone to grind, and any other sort of biological evidence that may exist on the rock is usually destroyed through the fire. Almost makes it impossible to date these things after fire's gone through, as it significantly corrupts possible readings that you may be able to get. And just once again, we maybe look at some of the, I suppose, motives for the continuation of this. And certainly, these sorts of burning off practices with its impact on cultural heritage within those forests do affect the amount of rights that can be ultimately exercised by Aboriginal communities over country under native title, and certainly the state-based and federal-based cultural heritage protection legislations. Some more artifacts there. Whatever the motives are in terms of the current continuation of a practice which seems to have certainly got significant scientific evidence to suggest that it's not working. Certainly the evidence in terms of its impact on social, environmental, economic, and cultural heritage type issues. It certainly speaks to the need for a different approach to be adopted, particularly when we look at, the effects of, I'm sure we're all aware, of, the fire breaks, clearing tracts of bush for fire breaks, increases the risk and intensity of fire. Removing trees that act as windbreaks and provides increased airflow into the forest, drying them out more quickly and more severely. And also removing, the root systems and structures which are, essential to moisture retention, clearly suggests that the current method of fire management is not appropriate and is doing actually more damage and creating more risk bushfire than it is intended. We clearly need to recognise the diversity of the Australian landscape, and particularly Victorian landscape requires vastly different approaches in reducing the risks of fire across the state, and there's no clear evidence that the bush burning reduces the risk. Re-establishing these sorts of natural fuel reduction systems in the forest by promoting habitats that increase insects and fungi and other animals that break down the flammable fuels. It not only reduces the risk of fire, but reinstates our forests back to pristine condition, for all of us to more fully enjoy and appreciate. Here's a small snippet of fungi just in my local region that are clearly, when looking at them in a collage like this, are like a little factory just breaking down all that debris. And as we found out earlier, there are literally thousands of species of fungi doing precisely the same job in our forests. It goes to the effects of fire on the forest is best, I suppose, encapsulated with a statement from CSIRO scientist Dr. Ted Edwards, where in an article he stated, what is relevant to the control burning method of managing forests and woodlands is that the macroinvertebrates and microinvertebrates and the rest that are essential in leaf litter breakdown in all Australian forests are entirely vulnerable to fire. Fire kills them all. In addition, we look at current debates around responses to climate change. It's insidious that the current debate to climate change, is increasingly targeting forests as the biggest threat to populated areas in the country, when it is in fact, more forests are needed to actually reduce the rising CO2 levels to reverse the effects of climate change. So, revegetating our forests to restore water tables held by the root system and increasing shade, are all factors that need to be a part of fire reduction activities, which are really not being properly considered. Revegetation programs such as this obviously has a flow-on effect to promoting greater populations of all the kinds of species that consume, further consume the fuel. And certainly in the face of all this evidence, the science presently being used has failed and will continue to fail unless a more multidisciplinary research approach is adapted to properly take account of, the environmental, social, emotional, cultural consequences of the present fire management. We clearly need to pause and review to assess this science. We clearly need to pause and review to assess the value of revegetation programs and reinstating wildlife populations. We clearly need to pause and review the effects on Aboriginal heritage, the oldest continuing culture on the planet. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we clearly need to pause and review to preserve, not destroy, one of the most diverse and beautiful countries in the world for future generations to come. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Yes? I was just curious to know whether you think that the evidence of Aborigines fighting white settlers with fire has been suppressed because we the whole battles, all the battles have been suppressed, the fact that the Aborigines defended their land?
Yeah, there's always been a huge, element of guilt that permeates through, you know, any of the research and academic study into the wars of resistance that were led by Aboriginal people. A huge denial on the severity and extent of those wars right through. I think it's part of the consequence of how we've got the debate today is, it is non-Indigenous researchers and academics that pretty well much have been, reinventing us from a rewriting of, the colonial history and post-colonial history and Aboriginal people's responses to that. So I think that's a real broad answer to what you're talking about, and it does come back to, there's still a very strong denial and shame about the way, the relations were at the point of first contact and for, almost 100 years after.
I think it's not just shame, though. It's also strategic to make it look as though the Aborigines didn't really care. Didn't resist, or they weren't numerous enough, or they weren't able to.
It's all perpetuating the primitive savage concept. I mean, in terms of looking at the Aboriginal history from the perspective of what's in our language is vastly different version you get from looking at it from that written by predominantly non-Indigenous people in a post-colonial context. So you're really getting a snapshot when you look at Aboriginal language of what it was like pre-European contact through the words and the definitions and meanings of those words within an Aboriginal context. For example, I've got a word here and I'll just refer to it very quickly. It's called Molka. And looking at historical references, it's recorded by Robinson and Matthews at various different periods. One's recorded as heavy fighting shield, and the other one's recorded as hairy caterpillar. Right, so in cross-referencing the word Molka through historical records of observations of Aboriginal cultural practice and tool manufacture, weapon manufacture, you come up with a description that a Molka is made from this particular tree. It's identified by the species in which the hairy caterpillar pupates on. So, and then you get a description of the Molka itself, and the amount of cultural knowledge that then evolves out of that is enormous. You'll need a stone axe, you need to know which particular tree, you need to have the right to be able to take stuff from that tree, you need to get a hind leg from an animal that's been killed and its leg ground into a bone to use as a chisel, as an awl. You need spear tips, you need have relationships with other tribes in your region to trade for good stone to make spear tips, and you need to know particular species of plants, for example, to make the gum to stick it on. You need to get seashells and a particular resins and mix them together to form all this equipment to be able to produce this Molka. And then what is the Molka? It is something that is held by the defender of the family, the defender of the tribe, in a lot of cases the enforcer of law of the community. So you get all this other information that comes out of it, and that really serves to inform the depth and context of Aboriginal culture as you know, as different to what was recorded by the European translations. And this is the sort of approach that needs to be applied to investigating issues around the Aboriginal heritage and cultural practice that clearly doesn't seem to be evident in the way Gamache has written his book, you know, The Great Estate on Earth, and you know, the lack of obvious consultation with Aboriginal people that's gone in to inform the, you know, the theory that he's pushing. So that's probably the answer to that. Yeah.
We've probably already answered it, but I just want to bring it up again. It's an incredibly pervasive notion that, okay, some people can acknowledge that perhaps Aboriginal people in Victoria didn't burn the forests, but they will always say, and I ask them where they get their information from, it is in the public imagination that there was subtle burning in grasslands, in Gippsland and the Western Plains down your way.
Yeah, certainly. And I mean, if we start to look at the scope that would have entailed, you would have had very rare reason, as a lot of it's been portrayed in paintings. And I look at it from a cultural perspective, and I think, you know, there's a kangaroo in a bush, and the bush is, you know, is only this big, as you see many paintings depict. You know, there's a black fellow lighting it to burn the creature out. I mean, it's a ridiculous proposition. Yeah.
To expand on that, the book that I mentioned at the very beginning, Dingo's Den by Birimbir Wangar, he said that he had much disdain for the theory of Aborigines burning the bush, and said, in 1971, a white researcher from Perth, Sylvia J. Hallam, wrote a book claiming that the Aborigines had been burning the bush for thousands of years before the arrival of the whites. From her claims, one could infer that the blame of the ecological disaster was on the tribal people.
Mm. Exactly. And I mean, and that's part of today's strategy, is to promote the myth, you know, that, well, you shouldn't be worried about what we're doing burning off, because, you know, that's how Aborigines managed the country for thousands and thousands of years. So, you know, there's our justification. First time ever that they're actually ever using any, you know, Aboriginal knowledge, reported knowledge.
Yes, it's the only thing they're interested in.
Promote Aboriginal culture, but it's in a really bizarre and benign way. So don't be fooled by any of those assertions, because I say clearly there's been a significant lack of consultation with Aboriginal traditional owners around the country in terms of the theory that Bill Gamache is putting out, and once again, looking in you know, one of the most pristine bodies of evidence for cultural heritage practice being Aboriginal language, there's no evidence in there to suggest that we've been burning forests and actively burning off practices in the bush for fuel reduction purposes.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.